The next speaker is also Rodríguez. José is talking about satellite orientation effects on center of mass corrections.
All right.
Just a moment. Yes.
Thank you, Toshi. Thank you, everyone, for being here. I always wanted to do that. They are approximately the actual sizes. I measured the screen last week. And they look beautiful, don't they? And looking at them like this, it gives us a very good idea of how difficult our job is. We are tasked with the job of determining the distance to accuracy of millimeters to some point to which we don't have access to with firing our laser pulses. And of course, we don't have the luxury of having this thing sitting in the lab. And you can ask Tom Borghese that even in that situation, it is very difficult to do. Of course, if they are orbiting very fast at up to, what, 18,000 and a half kilometers away, it becomes very, very difficult. And this is actually related to my presentation, because the way we do this, as you know, just to be on the same page, is on the one hand, we have the observational branch, where we have satellites in orbit and lasers. So what do? You fire at them, and we gather our observations, time of flight observations, which are trivial to compute, to transform to a distance, plus using some corrections. And we, of course, one single observation from one single station is worthless, so we have to accumulate them over an arc of typically 7 days. That's what we do at the analysis standing committee for our solutions. And on the other hand, we have the model, the computed branch. So we have models that take into account different aspects of Earth orientation, of the geometry of the stations, and the time variability, time behavior. And then, of course, we have everything related to the satellite dynamics. And the geodesist, the geeks amongst you will recognize there the three pillars of geodesy, so orientation, geometry, and gravity. What we do with that, those models depend on a certain number of parameters that we have to fit to the observations. And once you do that, this is not just geodesy everywhere. You have a model that you fit, you have to check whether the agreement is good. And we do that by checking our residuals. That is the difference between our observations and our computer ranges, in this case. So let's check some residuals. So those are, what, 11 years of residuals for the whole of the ILRS network. What we can do is check whether we have some strange features, because we don't want to have anything there. There are very good reasons, statistical reasons, why we expect this to be normally distributed. And we can check them in time. We can also then look at different stations. So that's Hersmonceau. We have an RMS of 5.5 millimeters, which is pretty impressive. And we can go deeper. And this is, we owe this to Toshi many years ago already, where he started looking at different correlations between these residuals, not just in time, but with different variables. For instance, this is a station, and remember which, instead of plotting it in time, it is plotted with the residuals according to the time of the day that the observations were gathered. And you don't see much there, but Toshi came up with a trick, which is, if you divide, I guess I explained it like this, if you divide the whatever variable you have here, in this case time of the day, in equal bins, maybe every 20 minutes, half an hour, whatever it is, and instead of looking at every single residual, you compute the average in that bin, then you have a much clearer idea of what's going on. So this is the same plot, the same data, I should say, as before, but now doing this averaging. So now you can see, maybe, I don't know, maybe you could think that here in the morning this station has some different behavior than here, I don't know. But the point here being that it is easier to detect trends and possible anomalies. Not only checking residuals, we have to check posters here at the conference. And this is relevant because Toshi has a poster about what I exactly described, right? So all sorts of systematic trends that may appear in our residuals. And I also put this here, which is a poster by the Boeing One colleagues. It's an online-only poster, which is very much related to what to my talk. So please check your Slack during this week and try to make it interactive. Right, so one of the most prominent features unearthed by Toshi's analysis was this famous now, a normal point, residual versus normal point RMS. So this is, what you have here is the normal, the RMS of the normal point, which Linda explained very well how they are formed and work. And here we have the residual, the post-field residuals after we've done our solutions. And we said there's an obvious trend there. So we don't know. Many people thought about this throughout the years. Is it a systematic error? Is it a random error? Does it really matter? We see that peak to peak, we have almost 10 millimeters. Are those 10 millimeters really going into our products? That would be a disaster. And where does it come from? And it turns out that the work we've been doing and computing the center of mass correction is very relevant. It shines some light on this. So I cannot go into the details of this. I will just say that the center of mass values that we use nowadays are by the design. This is a feature. This is a decision average value. And the way we do it is we take into account the physical features of the cube corner return reflectors, orientation, position, materials, refractive index, blah, blah, blah. And we compute the response of the satellite at individual orientations. But critically, we average them all. And we obtain a response, an optical response from the satellite that is the average one. But what if we did not do that? What if we do not average them? And I would like to see a video, please. Right, so this is similar to what Mikhail showed. This is just layers, it's just a video instead of just a static plot. So here we have the individual responses from the retro reflectors, and black is the average response that I use, and in red is the instantaneous one. So you see that this is normal. We are seeing all the time this, well, the kilohertz systems. We see how the response that we get, the distribution, is changing all the time. So every time there's a pulse, it's a different pass. This is accelerated, or this is going fast forward, very, very fast. So, yeah, all sorts of different things, of strange things happen. And it is not a problem, it's just a feature of the distribution of the cube corners on the surface of the satellite. So, having seen this, what we have just seen is the responsible for these different features that we see in different patterns. So here, for instance, maybe you're not seeing it very well, but we have retro reflectors tracks coming in and out very fast, and here not so much. And these will result in different distributions, which will result in different instantaneous center of mass corrections, that if you were able to do that. So the obvious solution here is, well, why don't you just apply the center of mass correction for the orientation, relevant orientation? And the problem is that we don't know the orientation. And even if we did, there would be practical problems with that that I'm not going to go into. But we can try something else. We can just try a brute force approach. I can pre-compute the center of mass correction for any given system for, say, all possible orientations, all possible being any sufficiently large number, 10,000, 50,000, I don't care. And then we ask nicely the computer to match the our real empirical normal point distribution to the one that best matches out of those 10,000, 50,000. And then we apply the center of mass correction, of course. And this is what we are seeing. So black is real data. This is a normal point. And red is what the computer found as best matching modeled, pre-computed distribution. And here we have the 2D map of the CCR array for layers. Yellow means that the match is very bad. Darker is better. And in red, I highlighted the places where the match was very good, right? And you know, we can go through passes. Not passes, normal points. These are 2 minute normal points. And you know, even if they have stupid features like these, we find the match, so this thing works. Sometimes it doesn't, but most of the time, we are able to match all these different funny shapes that we get. That would be the instantaneous distribution of returns, right? Yeah, so this would work. However, well, something of note is that I would be able to correct for an orientation-dependent effect without having a clue of what the orientation is, because we are just matching distributions. I don't care what the orientation of the satellite really is to do this geometrical correction. But I have to say that I don't like this very much. We will test it because it looks promising, but it would impose a change in the way we do things operational, because I don't see how we would be sharing this machinery with stations. This would mean that we would have to get the full rate data and create the normal points in a centralized way. I'm not too sure about that yet. But maybe there's a shortcut to all this. There's nothing stopping us, now that we have all these pre-computed distributions with our center of mass, creating that plot, which we've seen before. So here we have center of mass for all those 10,000 orientations, and here we have the theoretical model RMS. And this is already suggesting the obvious path. There's nothing stopping us from drawing a line there and just using that to read our center of mass. So instead of using a static center of mass, I just do that. I create, okay, my normal point is whatever, 14.5, and what the center of mass I should apply, the instantaneous one, that. And I tested that with regular orbital solutions, the same kind that we use at the, for the reference frame, for layers one, layers two, estimating LPs, station coordinates, and all the rest. And I applied the standard center of mass corrections for all stations, but for Hesmosu, I applied this fancy RMS-dependent center of mass. And we're going to look at the what I shown before, the correlation between normal point RMS and the residuals and normal point RMS. So that's layer one, Hesmosu, with the regular center of mass, the static one. And this is what happens when I apply this fancy new one. So this is 0.7 slope, and this is minus 0.2. Yes, maybe it overcorrected, but you have to take into account this histogram is the number of normal points we have at each different normal point RMS. So these ones, we have very few of them. So I'm not too worried. So this essentially flattened that trend that have worried many people. Layers 2, regular center of mass, and with this RMS dependent one, right? It just flattened it. But so we could finish here and say, oh, it all works. But I want to know what the effect this is on our geodetic products, which is what really matters, right? So these are the coordinates for Hesmosu, the height using the standard center of mass. And this is with this instantaneous one. It is very similar. It is very similar. So I have to really dig into this data to find something that worth reporting. And so you can use your favorite detrending function there, and if you subtract it to the actual heights, you get the RMS of the station, the noise. And actually it improves. I was surprised to see this. So normally you get 9.5 millimeters for that period, and with the new center of mass, you get 8.3, which is, well, okay, a little bit less noisier. Looking at the trends of the coordinates, if you believe this, which I'm not too sure yet, there are some differences, differences that would be significant for the sort of work that we carry on. And if you look at the periodogram, yes, the annual signal, seasonal annual signature in the new instantaneously corrected center of mass is higher, which, I don't know, this is, I'm speculating here, but perhaps because we are cleaning a little bit the signal, we are able to see the actual geophysical seasonal signal a little bit better. I don't know, might be. So this is very much work in progress. I don't have any recommendation yet. What I can say is that all these trends that we've been worrying about for these years is 100% orientation. Well, maybe not 100%. But most of it is orientation dependent. We can take that into account. And what all that means is that the average center of mass, well, we have center of mass values that are distributed about an average. So that's all fine, but we have to go a little bit finer. We have to do something like what I've shown, either this correlation normal point by normal point or something like what I've shown here now. The impact on our geodetic products, we have to say that is very limited, but it seems to be positive, slightly cleaner time series. Maybe it's worth doing this. And the instantaneous center of mass correction, the real, the normal point by normal point, it is possible for stations that have a higher rate of firing, like kilohertz and beyond. So megahertz systems, for sure, would be perfect for this. But I would say that more analysis is required. I'm not recommending anything. I'm not changing anything. And I wouldn't recommend that anyone starts tweaking things and jump onto the next thing, because it is not that clear whether there's something to be gained here. A little bit, perhaps, but we're not too sure. And with that, I thank you.
Thank you, Jose. Any question to, okay? Peter, wait.
Matt Wilkinson has found some interesting patterns in the, Hesmosu residuals. And since Lagos 1 and Lagos 2 have stopped spinning, there is some conjecture that this is due to the detection of the germanium cubes that Charles Town suggested put on the satellite for checking its orientation. Now, this actually reverts back to the first talk of this session. And I just wonder whether those germaniums can, in fact, help us establish the orientation of the satellite. and whether in fact orbit MP, which Matt uses for analyzing these residuals, is actually picking the orientation up already.
Was that a comment or a question?
Well, yeah, I recommend that we consider the germanium dropout.
No, I don't think the germanium cubes would give you much heat.
Well, that's the point. They don't do anything because they don't reflect the light. And so that absence of a reflection will help us take the orientation.
There's two things here, Peter. So one of them is whoever is interested in knowing the orientation of these things should obviously explore all possibilities. I'm not particularly. I don't need it for what I've shown. And number two is that I doubt that four cubes out of 400 or whatever give you anything. Indeed, in the plots, in the simulated plots that I've shown, similar to what Michael shown, right, with the tracks, I did not mention it, but they are not individual tracks. They are just groups of cube corner retro reflectors that just happen to land at the same sort of distance, and then you seem to think you see a track, but it's not an individual cube corner. You have 400 of them. So four of them, I'm very, very skeptical that it will matter. It won't matter for my work, that's for sure.
I would just mention that in the Lasios report, you'll see that there's a 4 millimeter dropout between the polar reflections of the ground tests and the equatorial reflection. So there is a rather large effect due to the germanium dropout. And we can see it, I submit, much better now the satellites have stopped spinning. Okay. Just a thought. But that thought reverts back to the first talk of the session in which the disposition of the reflectors helps to orient the satellite, and let's face it, Charles Towns has had a couple of good ideas already. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yep. So, thank you, Jose. Thank you very much.